coming flood for Israel, I present you this evening by the grace of God, Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 to 27, and also Luke chapter 6, verses 47 to 49. Those are the corresponding passages that we'll be looking at this passage which shows a wise man building his house upon the rock. So I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So what did Jesus mean and say, predict and prophesy with regards to this final story in his Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6 and 7? As I mentioned last week, you'll remember that it's the charter for the kingdom. Better still, it's the constitution for the tribulation. What do I mean by that? It's how Jews, that is Israel, how they ought to live during the tribulation, which can also be called the week of Daniel, the 70th week of Daniel, Daniel 9, verse 24. And also, it's called the week of Jacob's trouble, Jeremiah 30, verse 7. So, Jesus Christ here is speaking about a wise man that built his house upon the rock. We know from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 4, that the rock is Christ. It tells us that the rock that followed them in the wilderness was Christ. So we need to build our foundation, even we can take principle out of this as the body of Christ, upon Jesus Christ. And Paul elaborates on this for us in 1 Corinthians 3, for instance. So Christ is our foundation. So the wise man builds his house upon the rock. You'll note that there's a contrast, like the book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs, essentially, if you rightly divide the book of Proverbs, it's a story about the wise man and the foolish man. Very often, they contrasted within the same single verse. So you've got to take out what is wise and not do what is foolish if you want to be blessed of the Lord. As Psalm 1 says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and his law he meditates day and night. He's like a tree planted by rivers of living water, whose leaf does not wither. He brings forth his fruit in season. Whatever he does, he prospers. So we want to prosper. We want to be like the wise man. We want to hear the word of God. We want to do the word of God. Notice that both the wise and the foolish, they both heard the word of God. But only the wise acted or reacted to it and did the word of God. So the wise man is one that does the word of God. Further to, both of them went through these trials, tests, and tribulations of the rain, the flood, and the wind, the storms of life, as we could say. So both went through it, neither was immune to it. As his grace falls upon the just and the unjust, so too we see tribulation and travail falling upon us. But the Lord reminds us there that it builds character, experience, and patience as we go through our trials and testings. So nevertheless, when we look at this particular passage, there's three things to take note of that's spoken to us. And that is, the first thing is the rain. So we're looking at the rain and what that symbolizes. Then secondly, we'll be looking at the floods, or maybe firstly, I might kick off there. And then lastly, the wind. You'll notice that with regards to these three things, if you correspond this particular passage in Matthew 7, as I mentioned to you before, it's of paramount importance because it's the last things that Jesus says on the Sermon on the Mount. Kind of climaxes to this point. And if you correspond it to Luke chapter 6, verses 47 to 49, where the wise man built his foundation upon the rock, as I mentioned to you, 1 Corinthians 10, 4 is Jesus Christ. The foolish man built his house upon the sand in Matthew 7. However, if you correspond it to Luke chapter 6, Verse 49 tells you that he built it upon the earth. So it's just of importance to understand that where the foolish are building, they're foolish, they're building here on earth. Where the wise man is being said of the Lord, he's telling them, store up treasures in heaven. So too with the body of Christ today, Colossians 3:2 says to us, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. Philippians 3:20, let your conversation be in the heavens. Ephesians 2:6, we are raised together and seated together with Christ Jesus in heavenly places. So the body of Christ is focusing on the heavenly places. That's where we're going. However, the Jew is setting up the kingdom of heaven on earth. That's why they pray the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come here on earth. And we know from Matthew 5:5, it says to us that the meek shall inherit the earth. And Matthew 5 is echoing Psalm 37:11. That's where Jesus Christ gets that beatitude from, the meek shall inherit the earth. He's just echoing prophecy of Psalm 37:11. It's the exact words, replica. Now we know from Romans 15:8, it tells us that Jesus Christ is a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. So he's coming to confirm those promises made unto the fathers. So what he's coming here in this particular story, and he's contrasting between the wise and the foolish, and you can get focused on the wise man built his house upon the rock, like we sang in Sunday school. The rains came down, the floods came up, the storms blew and battered, but he stood. And that's the essence of it on face value. But really what it is to identify what is the flood and the travail of both the rain and the wind upon the house. You'll recall last week too, I mentioned from Psalm 37:4, I said house and temple are synonymous. So remember, we are a temple of the Holy Ghost, the Bible tells us. So too, here, this man's house, the house here is almost like a picture of himself, where he goes through trials, tribulations, storms of life, but he's able to stand the test of time and come through on the other side. It's important for them to endure and overcome. Each church in the church ages of Revelation 2 and 3, every single church was told to overcome. They need to overcome. But the foolish man, he's built his house on sand. He's built it on the earth. So he's not fit for the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. As Jesus told them, sell your belongings. He told this rich young ruler, sell your goods, give to the poor. Enter into the kingdom of heaven. So the kingdom of heaven is what is coming for Israel, not for us. Although we're in the grand scheme of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven is just a component that is the kingdom on earth during the time, the millennium reign of Jesus Christ on earth. It's not got to do with the body of Christ. We are in heavenly places. So let me just start with floods. I could hit rain with Noah and the wind with Job, but let's start with floods. So if you look in your Bibles at Psalm 66 verse 12, and Psalm 666, or maybe I should say Psalm 66 verse 6. If you look at Psalm 66 verse 12, it says there, through the fire and through the water, I will bring you to a wealthy place. So the Lord, if you look at Matthew chapter 3:11, John the Baptist said that he baptizes with water, but another who's mightier than he, whose shoes he's not worthy to bear, he will baptize with fire and with the Holy Ghost. So the Pentecostals and Charismatics, they make the fire and the Holy Ghost synonymous. They make it the same thing. And you need to receive almost like a second baptism, which is your spiritual baptism, and be baptized with fire. So that is contrary to what Scripture says. Okay, their words are a canker. If you read 2 Timothy chapter 2:17. Like that of Hymenaeus and Philetus. So here John is regurgitating the last book in the Old Testament. Malachi was saying that the earth is going to be a burning oven. That is the fire. It's the tribulation. They're going to go through the tribulation, which is Daniel's 70th week, or the week of Jacob's trouble. The tribulation, that's what they're going to go through. So yet Jesus, in the last story in the Sermon on the Mount, he's warning the wise who will listen to him. He that has ears to hear, let him hear. He's warning them about the coming tribulation. That is this week that needs to come upon them. If you look back at Psalm 66 verse 6, it says there that God turned the seas into dry land, and they walked through the flood on foot, and they rejoiced in the Lord. So we notice here that the Lord is going to be with them through this tribulation, and the tribulation is going to be like a flood. And the Jews are going to have to go through the 70th week of Daniel, the week of Jacob's trouble. And I've touched on these towards the end of last year, where you get the week from Genesis 29, for instance. Nevertheless, the flood. So they're going to go through the flood, but they're going to go through the flood on dry land. Through the fire and through the water, I'll bring you to a delightful place, a wealthy place. Remember, he told Israel in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. He says, "For I know the thoughts I think towards you, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to bring you to an expected end." Not only is it a wealthy place that he's going to bring them to, but according to Jeremiah 29, 11, an expected end. He goes on in that and he says, "If you call unto me and go and pray, I will hearken unto you." Hearken means to listen. I'll hearken unto you. I'll listen to you. "If you seek me, you will find me if you search me with all your heart." Jeremiah 29, 13. "Ask, seek, knock. If you seek, you shall find." He says, "If you search me, you will find me. If you seek me, you will find me with, if you search me with all your heart." So he tells them in Jeremiah 29, 12, that I said there, "Call unto me, and if you go and pray, I will hearken unto you." It's similar to what he said to them in Jeremiah 33, 3, which says, "Call unto me, and I'll answer you, and I'll show you great and mighty things which thou knowest not." Remember, Jeremiah 32, 27, the Lord, he is the God of all flesh. There is nothing too hard for him. So he's going to take them through this tribulation, this flood, this coming flood, the coming flood for Israel. He's going to take them through this tribulation to bring them out on the other side. Very much what happened with the Exodus as they came out of Egypt and they went across on dry land through the Red Sea and came out on the other side. So too, what happened in Exodus was a foreshadow. Was a forerun of what's going to happen in the tribulation. So, with regards to Noah, he was a preacher of righteousness for 120 years, and he preached that rain's going to come. Remember the story that Jesus Christ said, "The rain shall come down, the flood shall come up." He preached that it's going to rain, and he built an ark. But the naysayers didn't go with him. He was essentially the first conspiracy theorists, because he predicted and preached and prophesied about something that the people hadn't seen or experienced. They didn't know about the rain. So they didn't take him seriously. And he was a preacher of righteousness. And he found grace in the sight of God. Today we are preachers of righteousness. We found grace in this dispensation that we find ourselves. And we are preaching to others to get them in to this grace gospel, which is the Noah's Ark of our day. If you can get in the ark, remember what Paul said in Acts 27, stay on the boat. You may suffer shipwreck and go through trials and tribulation, but be of good cheer. God has overcome the world. He will be with us. So you have the rains coming down in the time of Noah. Now, Noah's important because of Matthew chapter 24. 38, because Jesus Christ cites Noah, and he says, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be when the Son of Man returns. And what essentially were they doing? They were eating and drinking and giving marriage and having marriage, etc. They were eating and drinking. So when you go to a story like Job chapter 1, and you look at Job's children, in Job 1:14 it says, the oxen were plowing and the asses were feeding, which is the donkeys. The donkeys were feeding, the oxen were plowing. And you look at what Job was doing in Job chapter 1. He was praying, he was interceding, he was sacrificing for that of his children. And if you look to see what his children were doing in chapter 1, they were eating and drinking. Same times like Noah. Paul warns in 2 Timothy 3, verse 1, he says, know this also, that perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. And it goes on and mentions 18 of these things, and the last one it says, and they shall be men lovers of pleasures, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. So in our generation, we're going to have a generation going to be caught up with entertainment, with pleasures, with what's in it for me. We're the most photographed generation, thanks to Instagram, social applications like Facebook and other things. We're engulfed, we're swamped, we're flooded, we're having this rain of evil, as in the days of Noah. They did evil continuously. And so too, these days in which we are, if you follow the news, you can see it's just evil personified continuously, unabated. As the scripture tells us in 2 Timothy 3:13, it says, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. It's not getting better and better. It's going to get worse and worse. But we are like those in Ephesians 4:14, because we are armed with the grace gospel, and we rightly divide, and we dispensationally consider. That's why it tells us, just before I get to 4:14 from Ephesians, it tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 5, it says, consider what I say and the Lord give you understanding. We've got to consider what Paul says in our time, and the Lord gives us understanding in that light, in that area. 1 Timothy 2:4 says, for God will want all to come to a saving grace and a knowledge of the truth. Now we know there's many people out there that profess to be saved. However, we know that men are not walking in the truth. The truth of God's word, rightly divided and dispensationally considered. They're not walking in it. I can show you a name, church after church after church. Somebody contacted me about a week back, and they wanted insight on a particular church which I investigated for them, and I said to them, don't go there, no ways. That particular church is focusing on revival. But revival happens in the last days of Peter. Revival doesn't happen in the last days of the days of grace. So, although what they profess is biblical, and it's scriptural. In other words, what I'm saying by that is that you can find it in the Bible. You can substantiate it in the Bible. They're not rightly dividing the word of truth. And if I go back to Hymenaeus and Philetus, 2 Timothy chapter 2:18, they professed that the resurrection had already come, and they overthrew the faith of many. So what Hymenaeus and Philetus were doing, they weren't, what they were speaking was biblical. It was scriptural. It's in the Bible. They were just not putting it in the right place. See, they were saying the resurrection had already happened. And if the resurrection had already happened, it therefore put them in the tribulation period. But we're not in the tribulation period. Because Paul elaborated on this in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 7, where he says, doth the minister of iniquity already at work? Only he that letteth shall yet, until he be removed He'd be taken out of the way, and then shall that wicked be revealed. So the wicked is only revealed after we are taken out of the way. If we're still here, if you and I are still here in the body of grace, the tribulation hasn't come. Okay? But you've got Hymenaeus and Philetus saying that the resurrection had already taken place. 2 Timothy chapter 2:18. They could get biblical scripture for it, but they're just putting it in the wrong place. Okay? So be careful to follow pastors, teachers, churches that are putting things in the wrong place. So revival will happen in the days of Peter, like it did in Acts chapter 2, which was partially fulfillment of Joel chapter 2. And Joel says in the last days, the men shall prophesy and the young men shall dream dreams, etc., etc. It was partially fulfilled. Full fulfillment will be during that tribulation when 144,000 go out. Evangelists with the ministry of the kingdom, not the grace gospel message, the kingdom. Matthew 24:14, taking that kingdom message to the outermost parts of the world. And then the end shall come. Not now. So you've got to, as I wanted to mention Ephesians 4:14 earlier, it says, and be henceforth no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, whereby evil men lie in wait with a sleight of hand and with all cunningness, with all deceivableness, they lie in wait to deceive. So be noble children, grow in spiritual maturity. I did a Bible study on that many moons ago. Don't be carried about with every wind of doctrine. Okay, these guys that come and preach about revival, don't be carried about with their doctrine. They're not rightly dividing the word of truth. Okay, stick to the parameters. Your lane. 2 Timothy 2:5. Consider what I say, and the Lord gives you understanding, Paul said. So we've got to consider what he says. So the last days of Peter are not for the body of Christ. We go look at our last days. And they found in 2 Timothy chapter 3. And if you look there and study, you'll see there's no signs. We're not looking for signs. Okay, Peter prophesied signs because Joel had them in Joel 2. He spoke about the sun being darkened and the blood moons and the stars falling from the sky. Those are signs for Israel. They're not for us. Our dispensation is no signs. Of the 1 Thessalonians 5:1 says, of the seasons and the times is need not write unto you. We don't go through seasons and times. We can't pinpoint a date. So the flood, this flood is the tribulation. The rain, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be when the Son of Man returns. And this rain that was coming, this judgment upon Israel. And so too, the wind. Now going back to Job. Now if you look at Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit came down, the Holy Ghost came down on the day of Pentecost, it says that it came like a mighty rushing wind, and it says the people, when they spoke in tongues, they had cloven tongues of fire. So you got wind and fire at the time of this revival. 3,000 people get saved. Remember when the law came down, Exodus 32, at the golden calf, 3,000 people died. The law, death. But when the Spirit comes down, the Spirit gives life. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 3, I think it is. The letter of the law gives death, the Spirit of life. The Spirit of the Lord gives life. And 3,000 are saved. And it mentions about the wind and fire. However, in the book of Job, chapter 1, it speaks about the wind. There was one of the tribulations that came upon the things pertaining to Job. It was a wind that destroyed. And then lastly, it was a fire that wiped out where his sons and daughters were. The wind and the fire. So we've got to make sure that we're on the Lord's side, so that those things to us are blessings and not curses. It tells us that life and death is in the power of the tongue, and those that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. So we've got to be blessed of the Lord, not be cursed. So the wind with regards Job, it comes upon them. They are like the donkeys, they're like the asses, they're eating and drinking as in the days of Noah, as in the days of Lot, as in the days of Job, as in the days of Jesus Christ, as in the days of the last days of Peter and Paul. They're both having pleasures and focusing on what's in it for me, what's happening now for us. So, also with regards to Jonah. Jonah went through, if you read Jonah chapter 2, when he was swallowed of the whale, he was engulfed, he was flooded. The word flood is actually mentioned there in Jonah chapter 2. So he's going through like this flood, the waves, the billows, and his experience. He was in this travail, this tribulation, going through this flood. And it tells us in that last verse of, I think it's verse 10 of chapter 2, it says, "And the Lord commanded the great fish to vomit Jonah out upon dry land." So this is essentially what happens to Israel, is they go through the flood, dry land. Jonah is vomited out on dry land. We'll know about Ezekiel chapter 37, the valley of dry bones in the dry land. So it's a picture of the promised land. God's going to bring him to this wealthy place, this expected end. I quoted 1 Peter chapter 2, 9 last week, where it says, "Out of darkness into his marvelous light." So Jonah comes out of darkness, he comes out of the belly of the whale into the marvelous light. It's a type of resurrection. He was like dead in the belly of the whale, and he's resurrected to life coming out of the whale. So, the coming flood for Israel, the rain, the floods, the wind, but the wise man holds his house upon the rock, which is Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 10:4. The foolish man holds his house upon the sand. Mentioned, it's called the earth in Luke chapter 6, verses 47 to 49. And these things that come, the rain, the floods, the wind, Jesus Christ is predicting, is prophesying. It's the last words of Matthew chapter 7 in the Sermon on the Mount. And he's telling Israel, he said there is a coming flood for Israel. Those that get into this grace gospel shall be saved, both Gentile and Jew, in one body, one new spiritual man. They'll be saved, and then they won't go through the flood. However, if you do not get saved, if you don't believe and trust in the death, burial, and resurrection of our Jesus Christ, then you're going to go through the tribulation. But you might not come out on the other side. So the coming flood for Israel, I believe that I've covered most of my notes just with regards to the word fall in this particular. It says, "And the foolish man built his house upon the sand." There was a great fall. We know in three parts, for instance, in Daniel chapter 11, verses 33 to 35, the word fall is mentioned three times with regards to Israel. In Romans chapter 11, from verses 11 and 12, it's mentioned three times there about the fall, the diminishing, the casting aside of Israel. Falls mentioned three times. And so too, it's mentioned to us that there's going to be a great falling away in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. A great falling away, verse 3. So we see Israel is going to be falling away. They're going to be falling into apostasy, because many of them are going to take the mark of the beast. They're not going to be wise, and they're not going to be with the Lord, going through the flood, being brought to an expected end, being brought to a wealthy place. But they're going to take the mark of the beast, and the Lord's going to take them out, and he's going to bring them into the wilderness, And then from the wilderness, he's going to bring them back into the promised land at the right time by his grace and mercy. So I just pray that you would warn your friends and your family about this coming flood for Israel. Don't get caught up in what's for Israel, but stay fixed on the foundation of Christ, which is our bedrock. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank you.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do.